So thank you all for being here and for staying. And again, a big thank you to the Little Theater for bringing this film here. My name is Helene Biandudi. I'm with WXXI News. And before we begin, I'll introduce you to all the panelists that we have here, and then we'll start the panel discussion. And just to emphasize that this is also for you, so we want to encourage you to come forward. We have a microphone right here. This is the one mic in the theater. And so we'll ask you to come up if there's any questions, if there's any advice that you want, anything that you may need or want to know. Again, we encourage you to stand right here and address the panel and the audience. So I'm going to start with Dr. Jim Colt. He is a cyberbullying expert, and he's written and co-authored a few books on cyberbullying. It's wonderful to have you here. He's been around the region speaking with parents and students, discussing strategies on how to protect students and young people from online predators. We have Karrie Formicola, and she is a parent. Her 12-year-old daughter was a victim of bullying for almost 2 years in her school district, and she basically championed an effort to get the needs met for her daughter, went through hoops, and I think that maybe there are parents in the audience here tonight that can identify with her and her fight. We also have Aly Belknap and Michael Kane. They are students in the Rush-Henrietta School District. And earlier this year, they launched their own anti-bullying, Take a Stand Against Bullying initiative. And we'll have them share a little bit more about that. And again, we have a special guest here. Miss New York is here. Thanks for coming. She landed a few minutes before the screening. And Kaitlin Monte's platform as Miss New York is the fight against bullying. She travels throughout the state. She talks with students and teachers. And she really teaches kids how to become leaders and stand up for themselves to help end this fight. So we will go ahead and get started. And I want to start by just digging in and addressing why we're here tonight, why Lee Hirsch would see the need to create a film like this, the impact that it has right now. And the question is, you know, has this been an issue all along, or is it something that we're really just now starting to focus on? It's something that is being called a crisis, yet when I talk to people, when I talk to students and parents, they also say that it is a social norm. So I want to dig in. I want to start with you, Dr. Colt. What are the misperceptions? What has been lacking to not be able to address this issue the way in which parents and young people feel their needs need to be met?
Well, I think the biggest part of it is the awareness piece. And you mentioned that question. Is this a new thing? Is it becoming worse? Those are questions that we grapple with. I think that we're certainly seeing some more severe cases, especially with the cyber side of it, which we could talk about. But I think bullying has always been around. I think it's always existed. I think that there's been so much attention and research focused on it, which is such a great thing. But it's taken time. In the United States, it's amazing to think that it took until the 1990s before any research really was produced on bullying, the 1990s. So now that we're into the next century, and it's just now starting to take off, it's amazing how slow that can be. But I think that I wouldn't say that it's an epidemic, but I would say it's a significant problem that definitely occurs in our schools and absolutely needs to be addressed. And that's what I appreciate about this film, is that it taps into the emotion of bullying. Bullying is that. It's the pain, it's the emotional suffering, it's depression, all the most negative emotions that you could think of. True bullying, that's what the victims experience, and they often experience it alone. But tonight, we were able to share in some of that pain, and hopefully that turns into something positive.
And Kaitlin, I've talked with you before, and we've talked about the fact that there's more of a social acceptance, it seems to be, in society. And I'm questioning, and I've talked to people before about this, and they wonder, are kids not able to define what bullying is? Are they able to pinpoint what it is exactly, or how do you draw the line? How can they tell whether this is harmful teasing or harmless teasing?
Yeah, when I talk to kids, I try to give them a clear definition because I think that's what they need and what they want. And teasing is when everyone's in on the joke and everyone's laughing. To me, and what I tell them is bullying is when someone's getting hurt by the teasing, they tell them that and someone continues to do it. So it's the clear kind of malicious intent behind it. And I think that when you look at what kids are watching on television, if you look at reality show culture, if you even look at politics now, they're not learning anything better than how they're behaving to each other. There's no role models. And then if parents aren't stepping up, if teachers aren't stepping up, and if someone isn't giving them guidelines, then they just don't know how else to act, and they don't know what's bullying and what's just normal behavior and how you treat someone. And growing up, I was victimized and went through that, and I was just nothing. I never came home bloody, but I definitely came home hurt. And more importantly, I had siblings who were disabled who were certainly victimized for their differences, and that was just okay. It was okay to treat Peter badly because you could get away with pulling a joke on him, and it was funny. And no one knew that over the years I was watching my brother die. And he was alive, but like he's gone in many ways to me emotionally because of what he went through. So I think no one's giving kids guidelines, or at least not enough. And you see in the film, and I'm sure many of you saw, there were parents who were trying to, but then they face teachers who are not helping, and it needs to be all of the community. It has to be everyone right down to the bus drivers, as we saw, and the shop owners, that there's no place where someone won't tell the kids to stop if it's the wrong behavior, and they have to know what wrong is.
And it seemed to be, as we watched the film, in terms of having a strategy in place within schools, there wasn't that thing, that extra punch that, you know, we saw with the example of the assistant principal who just wasn't getting it. And Karrie, I want to talk with you just a little bit about, I know this has been something that, a fight that you had for your daughter, mm-hmm. and when things were happening on the school bus, as we saw in the film and in the classroom. You mentioned you went to the people, you went to the school bus driver, and you went to the staff at the school, and just the proper procedures weren't in place. Is that right?
There doesn't seem to be any guidelines. Everybody does training to know what bullying is. All the teachers are trained. But once that bullying occurs, oftentimes the teachers will turn on the student, so they'll be quiet because they don't know how to deal with it, and they don't know how to make it stop. And a lot of times when you call these kids' parents, they're like, oh, well, they must not have meant it, or they must have been joking. And parents need to realize that, hey, if you're getting a phone call from the school, please talk to your child. Tell them that what they're doing is not acceptable. It makes it easier for the administration. But then the administration needs to follow through. And a lot of times you see certain students that have certain parents are allowed to do whatever they want. So there really is no way to discipline because everybody has their own set of rules.
And Aly and Michael, both of you started this initiative at your school. Obviously, tell us just a little bit about what prompted you to take on this campaign.
There was a girl who committed suicide in a town close to Henrietta, and it seemed to affect a lot of people on Facebook, and people were posting statuses, but it really didn't get a step further than that. It was just kind of, oh, this happened, and tomorrow it's over. And so me and Michael decided that we wanted it to have a lasting effect on the community, so we decided to go to our principal. And after we created a Facebook group, we started a group at the school and got a lot of people involved with it.
And oh, go ahead, Mike.
We now have like over 90 people in our group. It's going along great, so we're trying to keep it going as much as we can.
Well, does anyone in the audience have questions? Again, more than one. Yes, absolutely.
Hi. I just want to say thank you. Is this on?
It is on?
My voice is so soft, I'm not sure. So I was interested in forming an anti-bullying committee. I'm on the PTA at my school. I'm fairly involved and believe in the administration, but feel like there needs to be more connection. And they do have they have a no-bully zone. And they talk about it from time to time. And we actually brought you in. And on Wednesday, and my daughter, who's in sixth grade, has actually been a role model for standing up to bullying, and was on the front page of the Post at the beginning of the year. So it's been a talked about issue in our school. Wednesday, she was slapped across the face, And then a short time after, the girl that slapped her, who was her friend, came to her and hugged her and said she didn't mean it. She was only joking. And she said that five boys that were my daughter's friends gave this girl a high five after she found out that she had been slapped. And My daughter walked away after she'd been slapped, but was clearly upset and taken aback by this and confused. And the next day I brought it to the principal. He said it wasn't bullying, and I had some concern about that. He said bullying, you know, it was like a textbook definition of what bullying was. Bullying is happens more than one time, that kind of thing. So I wasn't using the proper lingo, possibly, I'm not sure. But then I proceeded to say, you know, I have a lot of, you know, nothing will get you more passionate than something that happens to your kids. And I felt a lot of energy around this, and I felt a lot of positive energy. Like, let's take this instance. You know, there are no protocols when something happens. My initial thought was, I know all these families of these kids. I want to call them up and have a conversation. But I thought, you know, I'm emotionally charged right now. Not a good idea. It may be taken the wrong way. I'm going to wait. And so the wheels got spinning for me. You know, there needs to be a protocol. If you suspect that your child is the subject of torment or bullying or an episode like I had, these are the steps that you can do as a parent. So I brought this to the principal and I said I'd like to form an anti-bullying campaign, maybe make it something more positive, calling it an alliance or something. He cautioned me. And I'm confused about the cautioning. He said, you know, if we have an anti-bullying campaign, we're gonna get a lot of calls from parents. I wasn't quite sure, still a little confused about that response. Then the next day, my daughter was taunted by a kid that every time she walked by him, he did this, you know, as if to mock her and that she got slapped. And I said, where were your teachers? And she said, they don't know what's going on. So that, you know, says to me, in line with that protocol, the teachers need to be aware, because if they don't know, we want their eyes and ears open, they want their eyes and ears open, but if they don't know what they're listening for, they're not gonna catch on. So I think that needs to be a part of it. But then I was met with, you know, part of this anti-bullying campaign, I would like to bring in the bully movie and bring in awareness, more of an awareness. And he cautioned me again and said, well, when we brought in Miss New York, a couple of the students gave her a tour. And it wasn't long after, I missed part of your presentation, but I think you did maybe speak about a hospitalization that you had, or maybe referred to suicide tendency or thoughts, I'm not sure. But he said that after those girls gave that tour, a couple of them were hospitalized. And that there's power of suggestion. So my question is, you know,
we have a couple questions here.
Yes.
It sounds like first you want to know what can a parent do in terms of starting a parent organization to help their young people.
Yes. But then that last comment, the power of suggestion, I need some feedback from you regarding I don't know how to make sense of that. Is he saying don't do anything? You know? And why? Mm-hmm. And I guess why? Okay. And I'm sure you can't answer, you're not in his mind, but what do I do with that?
Okay, Kaitlin, would you like to start?
I know that with all of the suicide coverage in the news, that it became a concern where schools didn't want news coverage because they didn't want kids to get the idea. And so that's where the power of suggestion comes from. But my concern about him saying it's a bad thing is if those girls needed support and are now getting that support, how is that bad that they heard someone suggest that if you need help, ask for it, followed through, and now the teachers are worried? And I've worked in a school which is now reported as one of the most dangerous schools in New York, and now they don't report anything because they got a bad rap. And a lot of times the schools are protecting themselves, understandably to an extent, but at the end of the day, when you're talking about
victimization is a learned role. So what I went through in my childhood left me to be victimized later in a relationship in my life that I went through. So if we don't help kids when they're younger, regardless of what it means on paper for a school, I have trouble with the fact that he's upset that kids are getting help. That's odd to me that he's speaking against that.
And Karrie, do you want to address in terms of what parents can do?
The best thing that parents can do is band together. The hardest thing, though, is to get parents to do that. I've been trying for almost a year now to get a parent group together in the district that I am in. And what happens is they'll come to me. I get stopped in Wegmans, Walmart, any place I go. You're not going to believe what happened, or I know what assistant principal you were dealing with because he said that exact same thing to my child. But then when you ask them to come forward, it's, yeah, but my child is still in that district and I don't want anything bad to happen to them. So I think schools are very big on saying, oh, go to the PTA and talk to them and we'll get something going. But they don't really want that because, like you had said, it brings attention to a problem in their school. And they don't want to acknowledge it. Ignore and deny is one of the biggest cards that the school districts have. So when they have to face something, it's really not a good thing for them.
I'm wondering if we could just model it, though, so there's not good kids and bad kids, like, you know, the bulliers, because they're victims, too.
I think a lot of the bullies need that support, and they need someone to stand behind them and say, you're not a bad kid, because a lot of the people that bully are very insecure themselves.
Bullying, I don't believe in bullies. I believe bullying is a choice, and kids just have to learn to make a better choice. Yes. That every kid can, that kids have trouble. Some kids aren't getting modeled that, but I think it's a choice, and I think we can help kids make better choices.
Mm-hmm. How?
I think we have to role model. I think we need to open the discussion before we see an issue, so parents need to be talking. I think that you need to be involved in your kid's life in terms of, for me, when I was getting bullied the worst, my mom got me into theater because that was what I did. In other areas, she brought me to new groups so that I could make new friends. Mm-hmm. And her whole goal was to expand my scope, so I realized the problems in my middle school were not the end of the world, that the world was much bigger. And we have to help kids realize that. It's hard to do. We've all been in high school where that felt like that was your world. But I think you just have to discuss it. And I think also sharing stories. Kids are amazed to hear me when I talk about what I've been through. And I think everyone tonight, several have said to me that it brings up memories from when they were younger. I think kids need to see, like they were saying to the father, he never sees you cry. They need to know we went through this too, and I got through, and we have to talk. We all have to talk, not just the kids. Everyone has to talk and share.
As part of this committee, do you think having a weekly roundtable discussion with the students would be...
A town hall.
Would be beneficial?
You have to put them on a peer-to-peer level because they're going through this on the front lines.
Yes.
And because it's so different with cyberbullying, I think you have to respect the fact that kids know something that a lot of parents and teachers don't, which is how to use the internet in a whole different kind of way. Mm-hmm. So when you put them peer-to-peer, they talk much more, and you'll start to have real discussions.
When you get into the hows, I just wanted to talk a little bit about the hows as you talk about. That's one thing I noticed with this film is they didn't really focus too much on the bullies, and that's obviously the other part of this equation. And I think it needs to be a balanced approach. It's part of school climate, for one. There needs to be a culture in schools that bullying is not accepted. It's not tolerated. I think what we saw examples of were school cultures that didn't believe in that. That bullying was tolerated. You had a leader, a school leader, whose responsibility it is to intervene and stop bullying, who was absolutely failing in carrying out that mission. I think that was very clear. But on the other side, too, with the bullies, education, I agree with Kaitlin, education is key. Schools need to pick up their part with doing more to educate. If you talk about bullying, let's strip it down to its fundamental level. It is an ethical issue. It's about teaching our kids how to treat others. It's about accepting those that are different. There's research that shows most kids say they bully others because they're somehow different. They target them because they're labeled as different. And it does, it elevates someone's sense of worth, or maybe they learn that in their home. But there's lots of reasons why people bully. But that needs to be dealt with education. It's about empathy, tapping into that emotion. And it's also about knowing that it can't be tolerated. There needs to be a consequence attached to it. It can't be accepted as well. A balanced approach that way.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you.
Our daughter was a victim of bullying, and not unlike Ms. Monte, has taken positive steps to help herself with the help of us, her parents. Because actually, when we went to the school about what had happened to our daughter with a gang of people that beat her up, and we called the police, and the school was very angry about that. They don't like this kind of publicity. And what we said was, you have these signs all over that says no bullying. It's not accepted at the school. However, when they say that they have cameras that are watching, nobody's watching the camera. And these tapes get dumped without anybody looking at the tapes. So we had gotten a whole lot of people to come to a meeting, a board meeting of the school, and they knew that we were coming, they saw the group of us coming, and they stated that only one of us was able to speak, and it was only going to be for 3 minutes, and that they would not address it. So this is the way the schools are dealing with these things, and I'm frankly really happy to hear that these two kids in Rush-Henrietta were able to bring this forward without any problem from the administration.
Well, we were lucky enough to have an assistant principal who believed that if we did our share of the work, that we could get something started. We have friends that, because we have a school for just ninth graders, and then the rest of the high schoolers have their own school. We have friends from the high school that have tried to start something similar after the events that took place that got ours started, but they have had no luck. The principals don't really take them seriously, and they still haven't had anything done, and it's the end of the year.
Well, I could say that I can applaud that principal standing up in front of the superintendent and taking a powerful step.
He basically told us the sky's the limit for what we want to do, and yeah.
And that's important. I think that's an extremely important thing, to have people in higher places that will stick up for the kids and for the parents, because it does come down to the fact of their funding and how their school is looked at, and whether they will allow the information to get out into the public about what's happening in the school. So what I wanted to say is that we had, as a parent group, come to that board meeting and stated that we would, for free, as parents, take different shifts to monitor those cameras so that somebody would be watching and see what's happening, instead of, after it happens, say, can we see the tape? Because it's not proactive. That's after the event. And they said that it was unacceptable. But I really feel that is something that can be done, and parents are willing to spend their time and to take their shift to watch these cameras, to see what's happening to the children.
As long as you guys stay banded together and continue to put pressure on the school, eventually you will see something happening, because they have to, you know, they have to acknowledge you sooner or later. So don't give up. Keep going, keep fighting. And I mean, your kids are so important.
Absolutely.
That as parents, you can't afford not to do that.
Well, we took our child out of it because they weren't going to help her, and we had the police on our side. So
I did the same thing. So.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you can only sacrifice your child for so long,
right,
in a system that will not back them. but you know, I certainly appreciate these two mm-hmm. kids and what they've done. And actually, I think are you Aly Belknap?
I am.
Yeah, I know you. I've known you since you were in kindergarten, and I really appreciate what you guys are doing. So that's it. I just think that there are proactive things that we can stand up for.
Thank you.
I've been an advocate for 20 years. I'm now the director of a nonprofit for children, for parents of children with emotional, social, behavioral, developmental, and learning differences. I understand, after being an advocate for 20 years, what these people are talking about, what happens to them within the school system when they try to explain and speak out against the atrocities that happen to our children. Our kids are all bullied. With the differences that our children have, it's a given. They have less of an opportunity, fewer resources to work against the bullying. But also, not in defense of schools, because I used to think I was sending my son to a concentration camp every day when he went to school, but the teachers don't want to see, because what will they do with that information? They're human. They don't want to see something they can't do anything about, because the administrators turn their backs, and the administrators don't have anyone to turn to help them to deal with these problems. It is so vast, so widespread. So I guess my question is, there is a new law that is supposed to be on the books in July. Can anyone speak to that law?
Is that
about
the cyberbullying law?
I'm not certain what it is.
Dignity for
it's
All Students.
Yeah, it's called the Dignity for All Students Act.
Yes.
And I do have to say, too, I do work in a school district in an administrative role that's related to safety and security, and work with local districts, and I'm a school board member as well. But so I do want to also say that there are that we can't be overly negative on schools sometimes. I think we have to realize, too, that there's so many caring teachers and caring administrators out there that do the opposite of what we saw tonight, that there are success stories, that when bullying is reported, that there is an appropriate intervention, that bullying stops, and it ends up being a positive outcome. I see that happen as well. So we always have to I agree wholeheartedly, there's work to be done. Teachers and administrators need more training on the intervention side, and that's what that Dignity Act is pushing
strategies.
Forward. It's the real strategies.
Yeah, right.
And there's so many pieces in place, especially I work at Monroe One. The Monroe County districts each have pieces in place already. They have policies. They have programs they're trying to put in. But I think the training piece is what's been lacking, and that's where this Dignity Act is pushing that to the forefront. So I think that we have key pieces in place and rather see it as a problem that can't be solved, really as an opportunity here to make a difference. And whether people agree with the Dignity Act or well, that you've heard some negativity, the awareness that's come with it, and that's emotional charge to that call to action, I think, is coming with that. So
can you explain a little bit more for people who may not know?
Yeah, the Dignity Act basically is requiring school districts to have policies against harassment in general. And again, it's being tied in as an anti-bullying piece of legislation. Bullying is a big part of it, but it's against harassment and discrimination in all of its forms. Bullying is a significant part of that, so definitely is part. But it's basically creating safe, hostile-free zones in schools, and that schools have to do more in the area of training is a key piece. Staff have to be trained. Someone has to be designated as a dignity coordinator in every school building, meaning that if someone reports bullying, they're going to a specifically trained person. It may be a counselor, administrator, whoever's chosen, who is trained to deal with that and follows those procedures we're talking about, where there's an intervention all the way to the end. Because what is needed, when kids actually have the courage to report it, we saw tonight what the problem is. Mm-hmm. Kids don't report it to adults. And we saw why, didn't we? They're afraid, and they don't trust that adults are going to do something about it. They don't have that trust. We need to build that trust. Schools need to build it so that kids, our students, our victims, feel that they can come forward and be helped. Otherwise, they suffer in silence. That young man, Alex, was suffering in silence. He didn't trust, I don't think, that people were going to help him. But that's basically what the Dignity Act is. And again, I see that as another positive. Hopefully, positive changes come from that.
My 8-year-old is just like that boy, Alex. He goes to Canandaigua School District. And, I promise I wouldn't get emotional. I was trying not to, but my kid has been choked. He's been kicked in the crotch. He's been punched in the stomach. And the assistant principal says the kids are just kidding and joking. And when a kid goes to a therapist's appointment and tells this therapist exactly what's being done, and she says something to the school in the primary and the elementary, nothing's in place. And I admire you guys as teenagers to do this because there's no program set in place for bullying in elementary and primary. We've had 2 kids in high school commit suicide within a 3-year period. And I admire you for working with the districts, but I can tell you right now that that school district could give, do not care at all. And my son has had marks. He's afraid to walk to the bus stop. He's been picked on. He's been called a faggot. And it gets to a point as a parent that I'm one of the parents that gets blackballed from the emails now. Because they don't want to hear from me. And I wrote a 2-page email in regards to this movie with the trailer attached that you need to do something or you're going to have another kid. And what age is it going to be? I don't want to see my 8-year-old be like that 11-year-old. I don't.
You can call the New York State Board of Education. They have a student services program. And if there's an incident, document it. If you need to, take pictures. And then call them and say, I would like to file an appeal because my school district did nothing and I feel like my child should be protected, and they have to look into it.
I mean, his teacher will do as much as she can. She's one of the very few teachers that will actually stand up and go to the administrative and say, there's a problem. But when you have an assistant principal say to you that the kid's just kidding, I don't take that. That's not how it is. I was a kid.
And that's something, if you call them and tell them that that's his response and that these kids that are doing it are not getting any punishment at all, that's, if you call them and report that, they will investigate it, and it's somebody outside of the district that gets involved. So it kind of gives you a little bit more leverage, and that way they have to take action.
And I appreciate you guys being here. My husband, I have been trying so hard to push people to watch this movie. So thank you for coming to this area, and I wish that Canandaigua would wake up and see it too as well. So thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Danelle Evans. How you doing?
Hey, how are you?
Caitlin, I have a story from my personal story. I was in special ed. I was being picked on. They would call me the R word. They would call me the F word. They would call me Four Eyes, Geek, you know, TV, Urkel, Screech, all those names. I was very upset, though. How do you take it personally yourself? How do you take it personally, though?
What did I do?
Yes.
How did I handle it?
Yes.
There's 3 big steps that in everything I've learned I've been consistent. The first thing is you have to tell them to stop. That doesn't mean that you have to explode at them and scream, but it means you have to make it very clear that what they're doing is hurting you. So that they don't confuse what they're doing with teasing, that they understand that what they're doing is causing harm, and if they choose to do it again, they're causing harm. The second thing is to block it, and that means whether, if it's online, it means you would block it literally, but that means that you do everything you can to not put yourself in a situation where you're around them. And that includes going to your teachers or into your administrators and making it clear that when I sit near this person, when I'm in class with them, this is what's happening. I can't learn. I can't focus. I can't do anything. And then the tell means that you just have to tell. You have to talk to your teachers, to your parents, to your friends, because sometimes it's just a matter of if you have five friends around you, those two people who are calling you names are now outnumbered, and you're no longer the target that they're going to go after. They're going to bullies. People who bully want someone who they can get. That's the power thing. So if you show that there's power on your side in terms of friends who will stand with you, teachers who will stand with you, then you're going to send them that message. You've made it clear to them that they're hurting you. You've done everything you can to get away. You've told everyone you can. And then from there, you just keep telling. And a lot of times, like we've said, kids tell someone and nothing happens. You just keep telling. And the hard thing for me was my brother went through the exact same thing. And one day he came home from school so mad that he called the police on himself because he was afraid he was going to hurt someone. And we had to get a call from the police that my brother had put himself in the police station. So you need to make sure that you never act in a state of anger, that you have someone, a trusted adult or a trusted ally who knows you and would not underreact, would not overreact, but would just stand up for you. My middle school chorus teacher was that for me.
That was when I was a young kid, a long time ago.
You doing better now?
I'm 35 years old
now. All right, good. How did you handle it? Did you find you had ways?
I blocked it.
Good. See, good for you for being strong.
I blocked it. And I started special ed. And in ninth grade, I went to regular classes, and it was almost the same thing. It was exactly the same thing because I was sick at the time. I had kidney problems. I was very skinny. And only a couple of times on the city bus. It didn't happen here in Rochester. It happened in New York City, though.
Okay.
So I had my bus pass stolen a couple of times there. Yeah, I had my bus pass stolen a couple of times in high school.
Good for you for
being strong.
Even though
I was in regular classes, though.
I think it would be cool for you to share your story, too, with some students who you feel might be going through the same thing, because I think they would find strength in what you've brought into your life in terms of your strength.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for sharing.
Thank
That's
you.
Really great.
Thank you.
There was, I think it was a principal and an assistant principal that was saying how, bullying happens everywhere, and here it's not that much of an importance. We really don't concern ourselves with it because, it happens, but, it really doesn't really matter to us. I heard that in the film, and I thought that was, terrible. And I think that a lot of people who are doing the bullying are very hardened and, have low self-esteem and whatnot, and they feel themselves that they're victims, so they look for other, to try to turn other people into victims, and I think that's terrible as well.
With that, Aly and Michael, can you talk about just a little bit in terms of the reaction of your peers? And when you, I know on Thursdays that you would have activities at the end of the school day for students to participate in to kind of address this. So tell us a little bit about that.
Well, at first we got a lot of hate, take a seat, whatever, normal stuff. We kind of just blocked it. We went ahead with it. Everything was fine. We still get it. We just ignore it. We know that we're doing the right thing with helping kids get through their problems. I've had some kids come to me with how they address bullying, what they've gone through, and I try to take it and go talk to that kid. If not, I try to tell our supervisor about it.
Yeah, there's the kids who are in the group and are active, and the kids who, because our group on Facebook is a lot bigger than the one in school, because we have members that don't go to our school, that are from other districts, things like that, they really benefit from it. So the kids who benefit are really positive about everything. But some kids, like Michael said, they don't like it. Yeah.
Close to what you said in terms of still work to be done. Well, before we close
Did you have a follow-up with that? Okay.
Yeah, one comment. I was wondering if there are any middle school or high school students or any parents of middle school and high school students. Tell your kids to try to make friends. I mean, smile. I mean, because a lot of people, you know, they might be having a bad day, you know. I mean, maybe if you smile at them, you know, it might change their day, you know, and it will cut down on the bullying and the victimizing and whatnot that's going on.
Tell me your name.
Terrell.
Terrell? Okay, so Terrell concluded exactly how I want you. I think a good way to end is to each of the panelists just give a closing thought and just maybe a piece of advice, something. The end of the film said it takes one person. It's not a cliche statement, especially when it comes to this. It really does take one. So maybe just a piece of advice, something, so everyone, when they walk out of here, they have that feeling like, okay, this is something that I can do. Dr. Colt, would you like to begin?
Sure, I'll start. I think from a parent perspective, for those of us that have kids, I think it's important, and we saw some of that if they have the courage to bring it to your attention, that we have to, I say, handle that with care. Be careful not to overreact. Be careful not to put the blame back on that child. It took a lot of courage to say, that kid is strangling me on the bus, and we need to do everything we can to support that, to find out more, to keep them talking. And there's research that shows the kids really want us to listen to them, number one. If they're going to tell you, they want you to listen, they want you to give them some advice, and then they want you to take some steps with them to help stop it. That's what they want. They don't want you to overreact and go pound on the principal's door and subject them to further embarrassment. In their eyes, they think you're going to make it worse. Again, handle with care. Start with ourselves and give that advice about how to make friends. Great advice. Smile more. Some assertiveness training that way, giving them some confidence. But then the other piece is, if they're being bullied and they want you to talk to the school, absolutely do that and be the biggest advocate you can be, because schools have the responsibility to stop bullying. They need to make it stop if it's happening, and you're the biggest advocate to make that happen. Thanks.
A smile can change someone's day. A smile can save someone's life. You don't know what anyone else is going through, and whether you are a child or an adult, anytime, at any given place, the wrong word to a certain person could be the last word that person needs to end their life. So smile more, be patient, and be more accepting, because we're all different. Some of us to more degrees than others, but acceptance and love is the only way that this is gonna end.
From what I've learned is, when you know someone on a closer level, it's harder for you to attack them or like bully them, because you know what they've been through. So don't judge a book by its cover, because you don't know what that person is going through in their home life. You don't know what their school life is like. You never know. So I would just say, don't judge a book by its cover. And like what they said, smile more, because I've read stories like people will like help someone out one day not knowing that was going to be their last day on earth, and finding out years later.
I would probably say, to take away from the film and everything here, is that like, don't ever belittle a problem that's obviously there. If somebody comes to you with an issue or you see something happening, don't ever ignore it and just say it's not your responsibility, you're not involved. You are involved, because you're aware of it, and you don't know what could happen after that. It could be nothing, or it could be something really huge. And your steps after that could be the entire difference in the situation.
I think the discourse of this is getting difficult, because it's not the word bully, it's just being mean. And kids can be mean, and adults can be mean. But like I said before, we are all the authors of our own story. We all hold a pen. We each need to write a better line when it comes to this. Kids, if you're bullying, write a better line. If you're being victimized, write a better line, ask for help. You have that power. If you're a parent, write a stronger line, step up and call your school. If you are an advocate, show up at a rally, show up to support, like the Facebook group. Those things help. I started a petition this year after Jamie Rotemeyer committed suicide, just because I felt like I needed to do something, and before I knew it, we had 3,200 signatures. Senator Klein called me, and there's cyberbullying laws up in Albany right now that they're hoping to pass. So if anyone ever tells you, as a young person, that you can't do something, they're wrong, and you have complete power to change it, and no matter what someone tries to take away, no one has the right to stand in the way of your path to happiness. That's your journey, whether you get there or not is on you, but no one has the right to stop it. Thank you all.